TV online original webinar series. Today we have Dr. Madan Themkar with us. He is going to talk on guided interventions in common shoulder conditions. He is a senior arthroscopy and arthroplasty surgeon from Bangalore. He is attached to Manipal Hospital, Whitefield, Bangalore, and he has his own clinic. We also have on our expert panel Dr. Salim Patel, who is a senior medical advisor in Zydus Cadila, and Dr. Prasad Chaudhary, who is a professor of orthopedics in D.Y. Patil Hospital, Navi Mumbai. This webinar is brought to us by an unrestricted educational grant by Zydus Cadila, the makers of Nucoxia. So over to Dr. Madan. Just unmute yourself.
Yes.
Okay.
Thank you, Dr. Neeraj. I thank the organizers behind the scene who have been able to make this program come through. As our lockdown is slowly coming to an end, our time for learning is also reducing. Within that time, whatever experience we have gained to be shared with the others, that's the intention with which this program is being conducted. Shoulder pain is one of the common conditions an orthopedic surgeon has to face. In my opinion, it is the fourth common condition for which the patient has to meet the doctor. After back pain, knee pain, ankle pain, comes the shoulder pain. As the expected age of the population increases, shoulder problems are likely to increase in number. And it is ideal time to know about it and get prepared to solve these matters. This is a situation where pain medicine, orthopedics, anesthesia, radiologist also come into picture. This field is also getting attached to regenerative medicine in the long run, because so many of the procedures is done by regenerative medicine and pain medicine specialists.
Just click on the slide and then you'll be able to make it proceed.
Oh, right. So following the introduction of Dr. Neeraj, I have started doing some of these guided procedure in the last few years, and I would like to share my experience about this. The objectives of this small talk is to know where we stand today regarding the shoulder pain management, coming to about the indications, contraindications, equipment needed, the setup needed, and important pitfalls and pearls, and sharing our experience. I'd like to start with a basic small video wherein a small intervention is being shown where ultrasound guided needle placement and injection of the drug around the median nerve is being shown. We would see more such procedures in future, and it is ideal time for us to understand this and then take part in that. Being orthopedic surgeons, we are well versed with the anatomy of the tissues. We are dealing with it daily. Shoulder is a joint which is easily accessible. The anterior view, lateral view, and the posterior view of the shoulder with the necessary muscles and tendons are to be kept in mind while planning for any procedure. Long end of biceps is an important structure which would act as a guide apart from in arthroscopy, also in guided procedures. Similarly, the coracoacromial ligament arch, then the lateral view of the shoulder where the rotator cuff and the rotator interval have to be kept in mind. From the posterior aspect, two important muscles, infraspinatus and teres minor, would take part during the interventional procedures, along with the labrum, posterior labrum of the shoulder. Guided procedures can be easily classified into three: CT guided, C-arm guided, and ultrasound guided. CT guided procedure is something which is limited to some of the tumors, and there is a risk of radiation exposure. It cannot be used on a regular basis. CEOM guided, as trauma surgeons, we have been using CEOM, and which has helped us in reducing the exposure of the skin. We have moved on to minimally invasive with the help of CEOM. Similarly, ultrasound guided procedures are gaining in popularity because of so many reasons. It is easily comparable to the opposite side. There is no radiation. Post-operative cases can be evaluated where CT and MRI may not be very useful. I'd like to start with one CT-guided procedure which I have been performing recently, the AC joint instability. The AC joint is temporarily reduced. Under CEOM, the guide wire is passed from the clavicle down to the coracoid. Coracoid gives a shadow which is rounded at its base. So we need to direct the guide wire at the middle of the rounded shadow of the coracoid, followed by the drilling with a 6 mm drill bit. With the passage of the bead pin, which we do in ACL reconstruction, we can plan to do a procedure something like this. Get one endo button here, either with tight rope or any other method, and have a free endo button here. Initially, when I started, I used to put a K-wire to stabilize temporarily. And as I gained in confidence, we were able to do it without that. The crucial step in this is the knots being put on the endo button over the clavicle. The drill bit going through the clavicle should be at the center of the clavicle anteroposteriorly, and the knot security is most important. Being arthroscopic surgeons, our knots are much, much better as we practice further. So I have been happy with this procedure. Coming down to the role of ultrasound in the management of shoulder problems, it is similar to extension of a physician's hand. There is live evaluation of the patient, and we can take the probe to the area where the pain is there, and we can do what is called as provocative maneuver. We can examine the patient with the painful activity and then try to find out what is the cause. And these digital images can be transported easily. We can share it. It is also useful as evidence and further research. This has been a long discussion, why you need guidance when we are doing it without guidance. So using guidance improves the accuracy, efficacy also improves, the risk is reduced. Whatever we are doing, if the patient is under local anesthesia, he can see that. There is also satisfaction from our point of view that we are reaching the target. Some basics of ultrasound before we go further. I would not go into too much of physics. Ultrasound deals with megahertz, whereas sound waves are between 20 hertz and 20,000 hertz. On a picture of ultrasound, the bone appears white because it reflects all the ultrasound waves. Tendon appears gray as the tendon contains collagen fibers. More the collagen fibers, more is the gray color in the tendon. Muscles appear in between dark black and gray, whereas liquid, fluid, blood, fresh blood appear dark. The terms used in ultrasound is this dark color is called as hypoechoic, whereas white color is called as hyperechoic. Very basics, this is the console, this is the transducer. Transducer has a piezoelectric crystal which reflects the ultrasound waves on stimulation by the electricity. It also receives the ultrasound back, and it is fed to a computer which generates the image based on the number of waves coming back. The commonly used transducer in orthopedic practice is this linear probe, which is a high frequency 7 to 15 megahertz, It goes up to about 5 centimeter depth. If it we need to see a structure beyond that, we need to use curvilinear probe. Whenever we are dealing with ultrasound guidance, we need to remember a picture similar to CT. CT scan shows axial images. So ultrasound also shows us the axial images of the tissues. So if we keep this in mind and imagine this anatomy along with whatever is being seen, it makes our job little easier. There is a big opportunity for orthopedic surgeons who can get trained in ultrasound and then use ultrasound in their regular practice. Of course, training is needed, skills have to be developed. I have been benefited since I developed interest in ultrasound. Some of the painful conditions around the shoulder can be classified easily as conditions in young people and middle and old age. So in youngsters, it presents in the form of catching, clicking, popping, dead arm, or while bowling, something goes onside and he is not able to use the arm. So some of the common conditions which present to us are these things: joint instability, tendon lesions, rotator cuff tear. In most of the middle and elderly people, we deal with degenerative conditions who present with pain, stiffness, later on disability. Most of our interventions which we describe ultrasound guided are helpful in elderly, middle-aged. Very few conditions are possible in less than 40 years where ultrasound guided procedure can be done. However, we'll discuss one by one quickly. Some of the conditions which are amenable for ultrasound guided procedures are this: partial tear of the rotator cuff, whether it is bursal side or intratendinous, or also the articular side. There, PRP injection can be used for healing up of the tendon. Long head of biceps tendinitis following overuse repetitive injury also can be treated with aspiration and steroid injection. Similarly, supraspinatus tendinosis or tendinitis is also amenable to treatment with this. I'll quickly show one small video wherein the bursa of the subacromial or subdeltoid bursa is being injected. The advantage in ultrasound is you can follow the needle throughout from starting to the end, and you can watch the fluid being injected. It is delivered at the target we want. As we know that the subacromial bursa extends even beyond the greater tubercle, we can confirm the spread of the drug around that. This is one of the procedures which is very commonly done and gives great satisfaction to the patient in pain relief, and it reduces the impingement pain, and the patient will be in a position to cooperate better in physiotherapy and range of movement exercises. We need to concentrate at the tip of the needle. Now we can see the bursa completely getting distended. This is the advantage. It is an accurate procedure. Now there is no reason why the patient should not feel better. We can do injection of joint, bursa, muscles, tendon sheets. We can do what is called as perineural injections, particularly around the shoulder, the suprascapular nerve. In case of any masses, we need to tread carefully because masses are better evaluated by MRI scan. It is better to evaluate with MRI and then think about any procedure in case of uncertain masses. For the procedure, we need to have sterile environment, the probe is covered, and it is done in mostly the operation theater under sterile conditions. Some of the other terms which are used during ultrasound guided procedures are hydrodissection. This is a procedure where we use the needle path and the drug injected path for dissecting in between the layers of the tissues. This is median nerve, and in between the flexor retinaculum, the drug is being injected to dissect the median nerve from the flexor retinaculum so that the nerve is freed of its compression. This is called as halo, making a halo around the structure so that it is dissected from 360 degrees around the structure. Hydrodistension is a word which is used whenever we are dealing with frozen shoulder to distend the narrowed capsule and get the range of movement back. Another term which is commonly used is percutaneous multiple needle puncture. The role in shoulder is a little less. Here we use it for calcific tendinitis, where the calcific tendon, calcified spot, is punctured with multiple punctures, and then saline is injected to dilute it and aspirate it back so that it is softened and it gets absorbed. Whatever small parts of the calcific spot is left get absorbed over a period of time. While doing any procedure, the ergonomics are most important. The surgeon should be comfortably placed, the probe is to be comfortably placed, and the trained assistant should be there. The monitor is placed at a comfortable height, and you cannot change the posture in between once the procedure is started. So we need to have a plan and then go ahead. Some of the other terms which are used during this procedure are long axis approach and short axis. When the needle is parallel to the probe, we call it as long axis. When the needle is at right angles, we call it as short axis. There are some needle dynamics which are important. When the bevel is directed down, when the needle is pushed, it goes up. These are important when we are dealing with moving the needle over a long distance. When the bevel is up, the needle moves down. These things can be utilized to localize the needle. Similarly, there are other techniques which can be used. We can bend the needle with a stilet to reach superficial structures, and we can use a spacer to improve the visibility. As the fluid is a very good conductor of ultrasound wave, a fluid filled spacer would enhance the picture. Longitudinal axis is also called as the in-plane approach. This is commonly used. Whole of the needle is seen, whereas out-of-plane approach, only the cross-section of the needle is seen. So out-of-plane approach is slightly difficult. Beginners usually use in-plane approach. As you gain experience out-of-plane, particularly for structures which are deeply placed, out-of-plane approach is good. This is called as out of plane. This is, I'm showing you a picture for injection for suprascapular nerve dissection. Some of the difficulties in out of approach is whether the needle is tip is at the probe level or it has gone beyond, it appears same. So we need to move the probe along with the tip of the needle. These things one will pick up as we do a few cases. So we need to move the probe along with the needle tip while doing out of plane approach. The other thing we need to keep in mind is the length of the needle. Many people start a little away from the probe when the target is deep. When the target is superficial, we can start the needle closer to the probe. Always we need to see the needle. It's like our triangulation technique in arthroscopy. Unless the needle is seen, better not to move it. We should not move both the transducer and needle at the same time. It is better to move one, bring it into view, and then move both of them together. There are certain techniques to visualize the needle. We can jiggle the needle, we can rotate the needle. Ultrasound is very sensitive for movement. So any saline injection of 1 ml, 2 ml can be easily picked up. We can also put Doppler to see the movement of the tissues. What drugs are used for injection? Since we use local anesthesia and steroids, it is better to know in detail about it. For hydrodilatation, normal saline is used. Remember, it's not distilled water, it is normal saline. Steroid, different types of steroids are available. Then PRP, nowadays viscous supplementation, any anesthetic agent for post-procedure pain relief is used. These are the exhaustive list of procedures which can be done with the help of ultrasound around the shoulder joint. I'll pick up few of them commonly being done. Good imaging is a must. Unless we see the structure well, unless we hold the structure under vision, the intervention will not be very, very successful. So local anesthetic, we should be aware because the anesthetist will be using, we are going to use it. So we should be aware of the maximum dose. Better to liaise with the anesthetist and use the local anesthetic from one bowl so that the chances of toxicity would be less. In my practice for the last 4 or 5 years, only in one case we had some difficulty stimulation of the central nervous system, which is quite rare, and we should be prepared to face it. Whenever the anesthetist is using lignocaine or bupivacaine, I use ropivacaine so that the we won't cross the toxic levels. We should be very careful in people who are thin, who are less weight, so that we will not cross it. Dilution of the local anesthetic adds to volume to expand the tissue. So even if it is recommended as 0.25%, if we dilute it double, it will become 0.1. So we can use double the volume. These are some of the intricacies one should be aware while using these agents. Methylprednisolone is one of the long-acting steroid being used. That has some disadvantage of causing particles which can block the needle. I have been happy with the triamcinolone, which doesn't cause a particulate debris. Some of the risks while using steroid, we should be aware. Many a times the patient would be happy about the pain relief, but a small depigmentation around the injection area will keep somebody worried about it. So it's better to keep him or her prepared for that so that the effectiveness would not get reduced. Fortunately, steroid complications are very, very rare. When we have to do an intervention, we have to plan it, whether it is indicated, what is the diagnosis, we need to go through the investigations already done and whatever medications patient is on, plan the procedure, explain the procedure to the patient, explain the procedure to the assistant who is going to help you. Without an assistant, it is difficult to do this procedure. As we go further, you will come to know about it. The equipment have to be tested. Many a times when you are doing a procedure which nobody else is doing, you have to start from zero. So everything you need to keep it ready, have a look at it before we start. Once we are into a sterile field, we can't go and touch the ultrasound machine. So somebody, assistant who can increase the depth, decrease the depth, change the focus is a must. Probe covers, sterile probe covers are nowadays available, which are have reduced the burden on us. Earlier we used to use betadine scrub, now we can use the sterile probe cover. Sterile jelly is also available. Though it is costly, it is worth it. Most of the procedures we can record it, we can take pictures in the ultrasound machine itself. This is just an example of one of the pictures. When we do it for the shoulder, starting from above, this is the skin, subcutaneous fat, deltoid muscle. We can see the muscle fibers here. Then this is the rotator cuff. In between the deltoid and the rotator cuff, there is a thin hypoechoic line. That is the subdeltoid subacromial bursa. Below the rotator cuff, which is attached to the greater tuberosity, we have another hypoechoic line. This is the hyaline articular cartilage of the head of the humerus. To this extent, we can see the interior of the shoulder And this is the path of the needle for us to use to enter into the subdeltoid subacromial bursa. Normally, it's a collapsed bursa. Unless there is inflammation, unless thickening of the bursa, we don't see it. Whereas when we put the needle and inject, we can see the bursa getting distended. This is one of the commonest procedure being done for subacromial impingement under the acromion and under the deltoid muscle. It is injected. What I normally use is ropivacaine, which comes as 20 ml vial, is diluted with 80 milligram of triamcinolone and injected under local anesthesia with in-plane approach. I am most comfortable using it in lying down position. The risk of patient developing vasovagal syncope is less. And as I mentioned already, patient should be comfortable, surgeon should be comfortable. The bursa extends quite beyond greater tubercle. That can be confirmed while injecting this. So we have to always see the structures in two planes. As we do in X-ray AP lateral, we have to see the structures in longitudinal view and in cross-sectional view. This is the longitudinal view of the rotator cuff insertion. Same rotator cuff is being seen under short axis. We can assess the thickness of the rotator cuff and the fact that the needle is correctly placed at the bursa. This is an example of a small procedure being done wherein the probe is being placed in two planes. Now it is in a longitudinal plane. I am rotating it to short axis plane to see and confirm that the needle which I am putting for subacromial bursa is in the correct plane. The other condition where ultrasound guided procedure is very useful is calcific tendinitis. It's a very painful condition. In about 10% it is bilateral. Even though there is no pain, if you do an X-ray on the opposite side or do a ultrasound scan, we can pick up calcific spots on the opposite side. In the ultrasound, the calcium deposit in the tendon creates a very discernible shadow. We can rarely miss it in the ultrasound scan. This is a small procedure of injecting for the calcification in the tendon. The needle is coming from this side. Multiple punctures are made, particularly if the calcified spot is tough, and saline is injected to dilute it and reabsorb, aspirate it back. Two methods are there, single needle technique and double needle. I have been happy with using single needle technique where we can, only thing is we should not aspirate first. When we reach the calcified spot, we need to inject saline first, dilute it, and then start aspirating. Sometimes we need to change the needle as the needle can get blocked with these calcium deposits. It's another satisfying procedure where pain relief is very good. This is an example of barbotage being done. Barbotage is a procedure where we inject near the calcified spot. The needle is coming from here, and do multiple punctures there to allow the calcified spot to dilute with saline and it is reabsorbed. So this is a picture where the calcified spot saline has been injected and is being aspirated. Next, one of the commonest conditions which we are facing is a painful shoulder getting converted into a painful stiff shoulder. It takes over a period of about 10 to 12 months. The pathogenesis is something like this. It takes about 3 to 4 months for the patient to realize that there is a problem. And it takes some more time for the general practitioner treatment to fail. And then the patient comes to an orthopedic surgeon. So all this time, we have options to do a shoulder intervention, even in this stage, and at this stage we can interfere and then stop the progress of the disease to go to painful stiff shoulder. As we all know, pain causes reduced movement. Due to that, the muscle strength reduces, stiffness comes in. It's a vicious cycle. This vicious cycle can be broken at any stage with the help of these interventions. One of the commonest pathology which is reported is thickened coracohumeral ligament, which forms the roof of the bicipital groove, and external rotation deficit due to capsular contracture. Here, we can inject the diluted steroid with high volume saline around the origin of bicipital tendon where the coracohumeral ligament is attached. Thickening of the coracohumeral ligament is one of the cause for one of the important pathogenesis for this condition. Manipulation followed by the injection will help in reducing the discomfort, getting the movement back. I have been comfortable with this procedure. This is where the needle is brought. This is the long head of biceps. This is subscapularis, which is attached to the lesser tuberosity, supraspinatus. Here the needle is brought, and if we inject around 40 ml here, it is likely to go also into the glenohumeral joint. Also, it helps in the distension of coracohumeral ligament, which is said to be here. Further details of the same procedure. I'll just show you a small video of injection around the... this is the bicipital groove where the bicipital tendon is there. The subscapularis is attached to lesser tuberosity. This is the greater tuberosity. Needle is coming from here. So we need to inject around the tendon, into the tendon sheath, bicipital tendon sheath. When we inject the saline, the distension occurs, and then the capsular shrinkage is likely to relax. Limitation of external rotation can be immediately seen on the table, which is corrected after the injection. Other small procedures which are helpful are spinoglenoid and suprascapular notch area, where we can have cysts which can press on the suprascapular nerve branches, cause wasting of the muscles. This is how the suprascapular notch with the nerve is seen over ultrasound. A long needle can be passed there to have hydrodissection around the suprascapular nerve. The cysts can be aspirated and steroid can be injected to prevent further cyst development. Glenohumeral joint can be injected both from the anterior aspect and from the posterior aspect. There are some contraindications which we need to keep in mind while doing these procedures. One should be assured of the skills he has developed before going into it. Initially, better to have an experienced person along and then go ahead. Nobody has learned, so we need to learn over a period of time. Initially, we may not be able to see any visualization of the structures is difficult. Ultrasound knowledge is very, very volatile. The equipment should, you should marry yourself to the equipment, know in and out about the equipment. Each knob we should be able to know before we get into it. The techniques need to be, even if you are doing for the fifth time, it is worth go back to learning center, read it, and then use it. Unexpected masses, whenever you have, better to abandon the procedure, have the MRI done, and then come back to the procedure. There are some gray and dark areas, mainly with the ultrasound. I feel ultrasound machine is available nowadays with every operation theater. There is no reason why an orthopedic surgeon should not develop interest in it. Most of the anesthetists are using ultrasound machine for giving blocks. So this same machine can be used. We need to have a good rapport with the anesthetist, with the technicians, and then make it an acceptable procedure in the operation theater. We need to keep in mind local anesthesia associated systemic toxicity. Then there is what is called as government involves itself in taking stock of what is being used for the ultrasound machine. We need to just report to the authorities if we are using ultrasound machine in an outpatient setup. Most of the operation theater ultrasound machines are not reporting daily or monthly statistics to the PCPNDT authorities. There is always a debate who has to do it, whether radiologist or orthopedic surgeon. I am under the impression that very few radiologists have developed themselves to do interventions as a standalone thing. So most of the time patients go to radiologist and come back to us. So we are in a better position to follow the patient and do the service using the ultrasound technology. To conclude, regular practice is the key. This is a very powerful tool available to us. It is up to us to utilize it for transferring the benefits to our patient population. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Madan. That was a very enlightening presentation. Something new, which basically we should all explore in our day-to-day practice. I have got my inhibitions about having a sonography machine in my center. So I want to ask a very basic question. Do you have your own sonography machine registered under your name?
I am fortunate to have had a gynecology wife who is using ultrasound machine for last 15 years. Hmm. I have been using for last 5 years. Now I have added one more machine so that I can use it exclusively for orthopedics.
Okay.
Both are registered with the PCPNDT authorities.
How frequently do you have to do paperwork?
Once a month.
Once a month. Okay.
Yes. Yes.
And it is the online portal is now become easy?
About 6 months back, they have removed the online portal. They expect us to give a physical report.
Okay.
So in any case, gynecology report has to be given. We just add a column to it. Other scans done. Mm. Other scans done, whatever scans we do from ortho, I just add the number. That's all.
Okay. Dr. Prasad, do you have any queries for him?
Yeah, that was a very nice lecture. I would just want to know, is there any way where we can predict whether how much and how long the pain relief can be given in cases of cases like rotator cuff tears and things?
Yeah. If it is partial tear rotator cuff in a youngster, we are using PRP. Then the we can reassess it at every 1 month to know whether the fibers have joined together. There is a post-operative evaluation by ultrasound scan. So even the anchors don't come in the way of evaluation. So we can see whether the rotator cuff fibers have joined together or not. So since ultrasound is not a very costly affair, it can be used for assessing the healing process. Time limit is something difficult to tell.
So, we have basically, whether we want to decide. Now, we do not know whether the tear is going to provocate or not. We only, our main aim of treating rotator cuff would be to provide pain relief. Mm. So, is there any way where we can predict by just giving this injection whether we'll be able to avoid a rotator cuff a surgery?
Yeah, I have had occasions where I have treated a patient before I developed ultrasound interest and treated after. Same patient, left shoulder, she had come to me with a rotator cuff problem, 58-year-old lady. I have done a rotator cuff repair with arthroscopy. Right side, she developed about 3-4 years later. So since I had developed this skill at that time, I offered her ultrasound guided injection manipulation and it did work on the same equally effective. But if you ask me what is the pathogenesis explanation, that's a little difficult. Ultimately, when once the patient discomfort is reduced, our activities have gone back to original, we are happy. So very difficult to do a study where we can prove that this is better than that. And in any case, if this doesn't give relief, we always have the option of repairing the rotator cuff. Cost-wise, imagine rotator cuff repair arthroscopically is likely to cost more than 1 lakh, whereas these procedures may be 20,000, not more than that.
Right. So these procedures are obviously ancillary procedures for pain relief, like for adhesive capsulitis. I mean, hydrodissection would be just an ancillary process till the physiotherapy takes over or for the physiotherapy to act better.
Yeah, I would put it like this. When once a patient has suffered adhesive capsulitis, he is so much terrified about pain. If we bring the pain down and give little mobility, he will take over because he doesn't want to go back to the same status. What I do is I arrange for an intraskeleton block and then do the procedure for frozen shoulder. I put an arm pouch for about 2 days. By second day, passive and active mobilization will be done under supervised physiotherapy. Usually by a week's time, they are in a position to get back fairly good movement, if not 100%. And since they don't want to go back to that status, the cooperation would be much better. Anxiety will be much less. Initially, I feel due to anxiety, the cooperation in physiotherapy will be less. Now that anxiety is reduced. So very rarely I have been forced to do a second injection for a frozen shoulder so far.
Okay. And one more question. I mean, whenever we are, if we are, actually this question is for people who do not have access to ultrasound. What is the best access point for the glenohumeral joint from the anterior side?
So from the anterior side, it is best to go through the subscapularis tendon. We have to have the coracoid in picture. Next to the coracoid, we know the glenoid. Only thing is the shoulder needs to be kept in external rotation so that the subscapularis is covering the anterior glenohumeral joint space, and then go something similar to the lower portal, yeah. Anterior-inferior portal, something similar to that would be best.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Yeah. So one question.
Yes, sir.
As you have said about frozen shoulders, you were just talking about that. Suppose you get a very end-stage frozen shoulder with barely any movement and you plan to do a manipulation under general anesthesia. So when you inject, after doing a MUGA, if you like to inject something, what would be your drugs you would use? Would be a combination like a steroid with a local anesthetic or a hyaluronic acid together as a combination? And how would you go about it?
Yeah. I have moved out of general anesthesia for frozen shoulder manipulation because it's a very painful condition post-operatively. General anesthesia covers only for the procedure of manipulation, but post-op it doesn't cover. So I always insist on intraskeleton block, and under that block we inject diluted triamcinolone 40 ml along with ropivacaine. Ropivacaine is known to be acting only on the sensory aspect. It doesn't have much motor, and we can inject up to 40 ml. Two ways I do it is, if there is a subacromial impingement picked up, so I inject around the biceps tendon, that is in the proximal part of the biceps tendon, and then I go posteriorly, glenohumeral joint. So my intention is, anteriorly I am distending, I should not leave anything contracted posteriorly. So 20 ml anteriorly, 20 ml posteriorly. So this is the method I have been using, and it's not that published like that anywhere, but I have been comfortable with this.
And so post-op, what do you do? So after the injection, what rehab you put the patient on?
Yeah, 2 days arm pouch for the patient. Second day onwards, patient will come for physiotherapy. Active and passive assisted range of movement exercises. And first 1 week, they have to come back to me for me to assess the movements. When once the movement is maintained for 1 week, it is likely that they are cooperating well and then maintain the movement.
Okay.
Most important is the pulley exercises. Right. Pulley exercises and shoulder wheel.
Right.
Shoulder wheel, the last thing is rotating the hand like this on a table.
Right. Right.
So those things will definitely help.
Right. Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Okay. So now you told me that this is related to a commercial aspect of it. So you told me that you bought a recently sonography machine dedicated to shoulder.
Yes.
So can you just give little specifications of what we should be looking for before buying a shoulder sonography machine? Machine okay. which is dedicated yes. to musculoskeletal sonography.
Yes. Nowadays, we are getting machines which don't carry extra probes. Now, each machine comes with 4 probes. One is curvilinear probe for abdomen. One is for echocardiography. One is what we use. Another is an endocavitary probe. If it is only for orthopedic, they will give only linear probe. So if it is a standalone practice, better to go for an ultrasound machine with a linear probe. And we don't need to go for laptop models. Laptop models, people have burnt their fingers. They don't last long. Better to have standalone model. And it should be handy, unlike what is used in general surgery or in radiology, where big machine occupying space would be there. And the technology is advancing so fast that we will soon get wireless ultrasound machine where only probe is there and a monitor is there. These connected wires are a big hindrance for doing interventions. In the operation theater, I have to hold it with one hand and the big wire will be going around. I need to look at the sterility of the wire. So if the wireless probes come in our country. I have seen it being used in Europe. I was told that because of this PCPNDT interference, they are not allowing industry to get wireless probes because that can be kept in the pocket and somebody can go anywhere and do an abdominal ultrasound scan. So in the near future, we may not get it in case the government changes its attitude. That's a big boon for orthopedics.
Okay. And so basically we should go for something which is like a middle range, neither
yes.
a laptop, neither the heavy ones, a
yes.
lighter one.
Yes.
If we can go and take it in the OT, take it in the patient theater, take
yes.
it in the patient bedside.
Yeah. And also you can use it in the OP.
OPD. Okay.
Oh, yes. Yes. It should be handy. It comes with wheels and you can push it to the operation theater.
Okay. How do you basically maintain the sterility? What do you put over the handle? Do you put a gloves? Do you put a
yeah, yeah, cover? Yeah. No, initially I was putting a betadine scrub on the probe.
Hmm.
The probe is the most important part of the ultrasound machine.
Hmm.
If the machine is costing 10 lakh, probe is 3 lakhs.
Hmm.
So we need to take care of the probe. Spirit is bad for probe.
Hmm.
Spirit should not be used. We can use sterilium. We can use betadine scrub. And we can use ultrasound jelly and put a cover on that. Sterile probe covers are available.
Hmm.
And use a sterile glove while using it. After the procedure is over, it is cleaned. And the only equipment I clean myself wherever I go is the probe. All others are being taken care by the technicians. Probe is one thing I don't allow somebody else to meddle with.
Hmm.
So we can have the sterile field. Sometimes we can use the endoscopic cover. this sterile cover is coming, which will cover whole of the wire also, starting from the probe till the ultrasound machine, we can cover it, but it adds to the cost.
Okay. And have you got any experience with the new WOCAD thing which has come out? It's called the human activated growth factor instead of the PRP.
I am still using PRP. This newer thing I have not yet used, but lot of hype and literature is still coming up. Most probably by next year, I should be able to answer your question.
Okay. Thank you very much. Thank Dr. Madan Temkar, and we thank our panelists, Dr. Salim Patel and Dr. Prasad Chaudhary. And we thank Zydus, the makers of Nucoxia, because of who brought us this webinar. And good night to everyone. Bye-bye.
Good night, sir. Thank you.